Thankfully, for their own sake, architects have throughout history been more than willing to bend to the will of the people. That's to say, to the will of dictators. Take Alexei Shusev. When he was 30, he was a vernacular pasticher. This convent is not medieval. It was completed only a few years before the revolution. He became a constructivist. Soon after, he became a neo-baroque decorator. Such lackey hacks abounded in Stalin's Russia, earning their Order of the Heroes of Ina Linguia First Class, accepting dachas and motor cars from the beast whose achievements they hymned. Now, such versatility was regarded with mistrust in the West from the beginning of modernism, because modernism was a sort of creed, an architectonic faith. But it was a faith that flourished in democratic societies. It was a manifest of artistic freedom, which its denigrators would do well to bear in mind. A work of art or engineering, architecture or craft, made in a totalitarian state is a facet of that state, a glorification of that state. It is achieved by its maker obeying state thought, or, terrifyingly, second-guessing state thought, which in the case of the Soviets was capricious, ever-changing. Second-guess wrongly and you might forfeit your career, at least. A dictatorship has to suppress imagination, for it is the enemy of obedience. During a paper shortage, caused of course by Soviet incompetence, Lenin pronounced that paper used to print poetry was paper wasted. Stalin was a different sort of Philistine. He approved of poetry so long as it was doggerel that praised him. O great Stalin, O leader of the peoples, you brought man to birth, you fructify the earth. This is a creation myth. No wonder he was furious when Roosevelt told him that he was known as Uncle Joe. It was an insult. It relegated him. A mere uncle? When you're the living God who spreads his seed to fructify, the literal father of the nation, who embodies the history of the nation, who personifies the nation, who understands its variety because he is, in his own words, a Russified Georgian Asiatic, an heir to Genghis Khan, to Tamerlane, a warlord of the steppe, an outsider to Moscow. Though to Le Corbusier, Moscow itself was the carcass of an old Asiatic village. It's a common characteristic of rulers that they should be outsiders, immigrants from provinces or dependencies or semi-detached neighbouring states. One thinks first, of course, of Andrew Bonar Law, Britain's Scottish-born Canadian naturalised Prime Minister. One thinks of New Labour, which is entirely a Scottish construct. One thinks of Catherine the Great of Russia, who was German, of the Corsican Napoleon, of the Austrian Hitler. Maybe only an outsider can take a nation's temperature. This Russified Georgian Asiatic, Lenin called him simply Asiatic, understood a glaringly obvious point, which Lenin had ignored and which Trotsky denied. Namely, that this greatest and most terrible of social experiments, this experiment forged in 19th century thought, this experiment that he himself led, was being conducted on the Russian people, and that it could only succeed if it took into account the Russianness of Russia. The Eastern Orthodox Church could hardly have been more Russian, but it was sectarian and thus a rival to be quashed. One of the Council of People's Commissars' first acts, only 3 months after the revolution, although that date is necessarily approximate, was to abolish the Julian calendar. The Eastern Orthodox had stuck with the Julian calendar simply because it wasn't the Roman Catholic Church's Gregorian calendar, which even Protestant Britain had subscribed to since 1752. So 13 days were famously lost, hence the anniversary of the October Revolution occurring in November. Where did those days go? People searched for them. They felt that they had been robbed, their life had been shortened. It was said that the days had been buried in a wood. But when you search in a Russian wood, you do not find days. Russia had broken with its past and had come into line with the West. It shared its measurement of time with what is now laughably called the international community. And so it remained till 1929. This is when Stalin's paranoid isolationism began. This is when the rest of the world outside the Soviet Union effectively ceased to exist. That was the pretense, the delusion. So all tokens of degenerate capitalistic cosmopolitanism had to be annulled. Tokens such as a shared calendar. But the Julian calendar could not be returned to because of its religious associations. So the Soviet calendar was devised. It was based on a five-day week. It caused such confusion that it endured for only 2 years before it was scrapped and replaced by a calendar based on a six-day week. Under both these systems, there existed a denomination of time exclusive to the USSR. Here was Soviet time. It was unlike anyone else's time. It was nationalist, hermetic, insular time. These were the properties Soviet architecture would henceforth aspire to. Stalin, in his omnipotence, could amend the unities at will. He could change the very rhythm of life. He was more powerful than the moon's cycle. He could vanquish tides. He could control the elements. In a folk tale, a state-sponsored folk tale, of course, he altered the Earth's orbit. He was a greater force than nature. He created inland seas. His slave laborers died in their thousands, digging bloated canals more ostentatious than utility demanded. Their function was to prove the state's might. Like the great dams, they were feats of symbolic hydraulic engineering. The electrification of the USSR was so much a cause of enjoined nationalistic celebration that parents were encouraged to call their baby girls electrification. It became a popular patriotic given name, along with barricade, metallurgist, oncologist, radiographer, slide rule, and galvanizer. Like many autocrats before him, Stalin determined to control the climate. Unlike them, he partially succeeded through cloud seeding to ensure that the days of great parades were clear of rain. Apartments were given Italianate features, and ice cream was made widely available in an attempt to persuade Muscovites that their climate was Mediterranean. Weather modification was also a Nazi preoccupation, and one that the USA, inheritor of Nazi science, has covertly researched. It is, of course, a means of controlling the production of crops and, thus, population. Infamously, Stalin had other methods of achieving those goals. There were the preposterous five-year plans, of which the first, self-congratulatorily, was achieved in less than 5 years. There was the brutal communization of agriculture, which occasioned the unprecedented enforced migration of peasants into collective farms.